Good evening, and welcome to the Newseum's Walter and Leonore Annenberg Theater. I am Jeff Herbst, President and CEO of the Newseum. We're pleased tonight, really delighted, to be partnering with CBS News and Arizona State University's Walter Cronkite School of Journalism and Mass Communication for tonight's program marking the 100th anniversary of the birth of the legendary anchor. Tonight's program caps a full day of events at the Newseum, in which we remembered Cronkite's career and discussed his impact on journalism, past, present, and future. Remembering our past, but also looking forward, is a big part of what the Newseum does every single day, where visitors can observe how technology developed from the earliest radios and televisions to technologies of today and tomorrow, such as our new virtual reality theater, which we opened just a few weeks ago. It's no secret that Walter Cronkite was a champion of the First Amendment and freedom of expression. He once said, "There's no such thing as a little freedom. Either you are all free or you are not free." The Newseum explains, promotes, defends the five freedoms of the First Amendment and the right of free expression. Over 800,000 people visit our building each year to view exhibits that speak in a profound manner to the evolution of freedom. We convene programs so that people of very different beliefs can come together and discuss issues affecting our foundational freedoms. And our educational programs provide teachers worldwide with course material that touches over 3 million students in order to learn more about the fundamental issues facing freedom of the press and the other freedoms that we value so much. Tonight, we have a distinguished panel and a moderator, some of whom work side by side with Cronkite to further discuss the newsman's legacy and to talk about how they are carrying on his work. Our panel is made up of CBS Evening News anchor Scott Pelley, CBS News contributor Bob Schieffer, 60 Minutes correspondent Lesley Stahl, and PBS NewsHour Gwen Ifill. Our moderator tonight is former Washington Post executive editor Leonard Downie Jr., who now serves as the Cronkite School's Well Professor of Journalism. Walter Cronkite's legacy transcends the generation of visitors who come to the Newseum, and we're honored to join these esteemed journalists and institutions in celebrating his lasting contributions to journalism. I'd like to welcome everyone in the audience tonight who's here from CBS News and the Cronkite School of Journalism and Mass Communications, and thank you so very much for working with us to put on this important event. I'd like to also welcome our Press Pass members, our Friends of the First Amendment Society members, and our corporate engagement partners and donors. It's really because of support from you that we're able to put on programs like the one you'll see tonight. Before we start our program, a special treat. I'd like to introduce the grandson of Walter Cronkite, Walter Cronkite IV, a Capitol Hill producer for CBS News, who will share a few words about his grandfather. Thank you again for visiting the Newseum.
Good evening. My grandfather would have been so honored by this celebration here tonight at the Newseum. He would have loved this place. I can imagine him enthralled by the front pages of the newspapers on the outside wall before he even walked in the door. My grandfather was a devout believer in the importance of quality journalism to our society. As he wrote in his memoir, A Reporter's Life, the free press is a central nervous system of the democratic society. While the Newseum celebrates many important kinds of journalism, including investigative reporting, advocacy journalism, and news analysis, he found straight, objective, beat reporting most important of all. The ability of a news organization to tell its audience an accurate, deeply understood, but accessible and engaging report without slant or bias. What happened? How did it happen? And why does it matter? It's difficult for a democracy to debate important issues while disagreeing on the facts. Objective and credible news organizations provide a shared understanding of the facts and pave the way for a healthy and productive debate. I followed my grandfather into one of the greatest of these news organizations, CBS News. My grandfather would be thrilled to see the way Scott Pelley has helmed his beloved evening news. In an age where both serious journalism and objective journalism are coming under increasing fire, CBS and Scott Pelley have doubled down on excellence and objectivity. My colleagues and I have the rare privilege of working towards a product that we're proud of and that we know is important. It's truly an honor to work on the CBS Evening News with Scott Pelley. I also want to thank Chris Callahan for everything he's done for my grandfather's legacy. The Cronkite School at ASU represents the best of what my grandfather believed in. And because of the efforts of the Cronkite School, the values he espoused and the quality journalism he practiced are being shared with millions of people who otherwise would have never even known who he was. On behalf of my grandfather, thank you to all who made this night possible.
That was great. Before we bring out our panel, I'd like to show you a brief video that shows the highlights of Cronkite's career from his early days in the news business to his life after leaving CBS News. This video was produced before Cronkite's death in 2009 by his son, Chip Cronkite, who is here tonight. Chip, where are you? I'd also like to thank Marlene Adler, Walter Cronkite's chief of staff for 20 years, for providing us with this film.
Ted Baxter, Walter Cronkite.
It's an honor to meet you, Mr. Cronkite.
Call me Walter.
Hello, I'm Walter Cronkite.
I got a call from Ed Murrow, who wanted me to come to work at CBS. Now that I had a family and a mortgage, I thought, well, why not?
Good evening, everyone. Here is the news.
So that was the beginning. Anchoring the news and covering the news, first on that CBS station in Washington, and then on the network from New York.
This is Walter Cronkite.
Everything we did was for the first time.
And you were there.
Behind me, you see the course of the Explorer.
Sometimes when things went wrong, they really went wrong.
Unfortunately, however, the film seems to be upside down.
This is Walter Cronkite reporting.
I was assigned to take over the CBS Evening News in the spring of 1962.
Soviet Premier Khrushchev has called for an 18-nation...
The Supreme Court today legalized abortion.
A flurry of activity at the Jack Ruby trial
we'll
today...
We'll try to suggest, at least, the enormous scope of the pollution problem alone.
The ultimate risk of a meltdown at the Three Mile Island atomic power plant...
I spent 19 years at that desk...
The Arab oil embargo...
...watching historic changes in everything from the world order...
President Reagan today opened...
...to clothes and hairstyles, including my own.
The impeachment of President Richard Nixon...
The 60s, undoubtedly, were the most turbulent decade of this century.
I have a dream.
There were the assassinations.
Dr. Martin Luther King, the apostle of nonviolence in the civil rights movement, has been shot to death in Memphis, Tennessee.
Most of the day, I didn't have keenly felt emotions, except for the moment when I had to say that the president was dead.
President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time. 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago.
And I almost lost it there.
Hell no!
I went to Vietnam for the first time in 1965. The American people were confused.
The firing still goes on.
They were confounded by what was going on, even as I was.
But the only rational way out then will be to negotiate.
I recall that LBJ said, if I've lost Walter Cronkite, I've lost the war.
The beginning of man's greatest adventure.
The landing on the moon presented an interesting emotional challenge for me.
4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
When that vehicle landed on the moon, I was speechless. I really couldn't say a thing.
Boy.
Okay, we're going to be busy for a minute.
At a time when there were a lot of other problems in this country and elsewhere, people were downcast. Everybody there was upcast. We were looking toward the stars, looking toward the moon, looking toward getting out there. There was a spirit that was absolutely incomparable.
This is my last broadcast as the anchorman of the CBS Evening News. For me, it's a moment for which I long have planned, but which nevertheless comes with some sadness.
Since he retired from the Evening News, he's been doing different things.
Yet the Hudson cleanup was a major success story.
He's done a whole bunch of documentaries, nature and historical, travel, a series of shows on Discovery. With me, we made a series of 12 one-hour public policy shows.
Thank you very much, Mr. Britton.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I get a lot of recognition on the street these days from little toddlers around who weren't even born while I was doing the Evening News. And it turns out it's all from dinosaurs. I did a four-hour series on dinosaurs.
Did you see that?
And little kids keep coming up to me and saying, "You're the dinosaur man." Well, there was quite a century. The best of times, the worst of times. But you know, if there's anything I've learned, it is that we Americans do have a way of rising to the challenges that confront us. Just when it seems we're most divided, we suddenly show our remarkable solidarity. The 20th century may be leaving us with a host of problems, but I've also noted that it does seem darkest before the dawn. There's reason to hope for the 21st century. And that's the way it will be.
Please join me now in welcoming our distinguished panel.
Thank you all for coming for this celebration of the life and impact and legacy of Walter Cronkite. We have four remarkably good people to talk about that tonight. They need no introduction, but I'm going to do it anyway. Bob Schieffer is an itinerant country music lyricist and lead singer. Who has been a CBS television news correspondent and anchor for 47 years. The anchor of Face the Nation for 24 years, the Saturday edition of the CBS Evening News for 23 years, and the anchor of the daily CBS Evening News from March 2005 until August 2006. He announced his retirement last year, but he's not going away. I think Ben Bradley used to say, forgotten but not gone, about retirees. And so he's continuing as a political contributor to CBS through the election campaign and the 2017 presidential inauguration, for which we are very grateful. He may not appreciate it as much as we do. Like Walter Cronkite, with whom he worked for many years, Bob got his start in journalism in Texas, where the journalism school at his alma mater, Texas Christian University, now bears his name. Among many other honors, he's the 2013 recipient of the Cronkite School's Walter Cronkite Award for Excellence in Journalism. Lesley Stahl joined CBS News in her early 30s and made her breakthrough as a correspondent covering Watergate. At 35, she was promoted to anchor of the CBS Morning News, only the second woman anchor at the network at the time. Lesley was the CBS News White House correspondent during the presidencies of Jimmy Carter, Ronald Reagan, and George H.W. Bush, and most notably for the past 25 years, she's been an award-winning correspondent for 60 Minutes, specializing in investigative reports and probing interviews. She also worked with Walter Cronkite when she was in the CBS News Washington Bureau. Gwen Ifill was an outstanding newspaper reporter at the Washington Post and the New York Times before taking her talents to television. After serving as chief congressional and political correspondent for NBC News, she moved in 1999 to PBS, where she is now co-anchor and managing editor of the nightly PBS NewsHour and moderator and managing editor of Washington Week. Gwen has covered seven presidential campaigns and moderated two vice presidential debates, in 2004 between Dick Cheney and John Edwards, and in 2008 between Joe Biden and Sarah Palin. She's the best-selling author of the 2009 book, The Breakthrough, Politics in the Age of Obama. She's not responsible for Sarah Palin. She only moderated the debate.
I kind of, yeah.
Scott Pelley, like Walter Cronkite and Bob Schieffer, has journalistic roots in Texas also, where he started as a local reporter and producer for television stations in Dallas-Fort Worth and Lubbock. He went to CBS News as a New York-based reporter in 1989 and became a correspondent for 60 Minutes in 2004. Since 2011, he's been the anchor of the CBS Evening News while remaining a full-time 60 Minutes correspondent. Every time we turn on something on CBS News, he's there. He has reported from the scene of breaking news throughout the nation and the world and interviewed numerous national leaders, two American presidents, and two Supreme Court justices. In addition to his many honors, Scott will receive the 2016 Walter Cronkite Award for Excellence in Journalism in a couple months. Bob, let me begin with you. What distinguished Walter Cronkite as a news anchor in his time, and what was his influence on news anchors to follow and American television in general?
You know, Walter loved the news, and he loved anybody that loved the news or cared about the news. When Arnold Palmer died earlier this week, it reminded me so much of Walter because he and Walter were so much alike. I never, ever saw Walter Cronkite be rude to anyone who walked up to him. I mean, people would walk up to him on the street, and I don't care where he was or what he was doing, and he had stopped. He would pass the time of day with them, and before it was over, he was asking them questions. And people, I think Walter was so interested. He's the most curious person. He had a curiosity, and that's what made him a great editor. I told a story last night at dinner. I mean, it'd be 6:20, the evening news would be going on, and Walter would look up and say, "How long is Greenland?" Well, who the hell knows how long Greenland is? Who cares how long Greenland is? But Walter wanted to know. And we called them WWs, Walter Wants. And we stopped until we found out how long Greenland was. And he would come up with these questions. I'll never forget one time at the White House. He'd call us around. And Walter was exactly on television. I mean, he was exactly in person the way he was on television, even that very unusual way he talked. And he was always asking questions. He called me for once in my life, I knew the answer to this question. He said, "Well, thank you, Bob. This old gray head just had a question mark above it." I mean, he really talked like that. I loved him.
Now, you told me back in the green room to ask you about your big scoop for Walter.
Well, why don't we wait for a while on that? Because it takes a little telling here. No, we want to hear from these other folks, but I promise to tell it, Lynn.
Leslie, when did you first meet Walter Cronkite?
Oh, my gosh. I met him, it must have been 1971. The Pentagon Papers had been leaked. And a couple of weeks later, I don't know, there was some time, it came out that Daniel Ellsberg had leaked it. And right after that news came out, I was in the CBS Bureau in Washington. Walter snuck into Cambridge, Massachusetts. And I mean, see, this was like a special ops operation, you know, human to whatever they used to call it at the Pentagon. And he was secreted in. No one was supposed to know that he met Ellsberg at some secret place. And he did it kind of late in the day, so they had to produce it at the CBS affiliate in Boston. You know, he was already, by 71, the most trusted man in America, as Lyndon Johnson said. He was enormous. He was as popular as anybody in the world at that point in time. And the thing that struck me about Walter, because I've known a lot of people who've had that much fame and that much attention, he was always normal. It didn't ever get to him. And that's, I'm telling you, that's pretty unusual. Yeah. He stayed just who he was, as you said, the same voice. The one thing, though, Bob, that you know that was different in person.
That's my stage whisper.
The one thing
is
that
it
was different.
Me or Leslie?
Oh, you can't hear us?
It was cutting in and out.
the one thing that was not the same off the air as on the air was his ribald sense of humor. You can ask me about that later, too.
I will.
When we warm up a little.
Right. Gwen, you're the only person among the four. I think it was only Leslie's microphone that was not.
Yeah, I'll just upright. Hold on to it just
okay.
in case.
You're the only one of the four who didn't work at CBS News, but you've been an anchor now for 17 years.
CBS would not have me, yeah.
Oh. I had the
Don't
same
understand
problem
why.
For the longest time.
So what influence has he had on how you perform as an anchor and what you see as your responsibilities and the values that you try to adhere to?
Imagine my shock and surprise and pleasure with the first time I met Walter Cronkite to have him actually with knowledge acknowledge that he watched me on the news every night, and which of course scared the hell out of me because all of a sudden you realized it was a standard that you were trying to meet. But here's the thing. So many of us in our business are attempting to achieve that level of trust. And what we know to be true about our business right now, television and newspapers and radio and blogs and all the things we are, is that we're not there anymore. That nobody looks at any one of us and says, you, whatever you that comes out of your mouth, that I trust. But the best of us are striving for that every single night. And we're striving for it with Walter Cronkite's face in our heads, with the idea, not that we're ever going to be at the place where if we say it, you believe it instantly, but the fact that if we say it, it's because it's backed up. Because it's reported, it's not just my opinion. It's not just my my bright, clever witticism. We are asking questions for a reason. You know, we laughed a little bit about the debates a moment ago, but the reason why the debates are important and why it's important who's on that stage asking those questions is not because of the personalities asking the questions, it's because of the answers that they elicit from the candidates. And whenever we get caught up talking about what the questions are, we forget that the reason why Walter Cronkite turned conversations with him on the street into interviews is because that was his way of reporting. That was his way of getting to know more. And if people came to him and approached him and said, you know, I know you from the Dinosaur Show, that was his opportunity to talk to someone who he otherwise would not have met. It's the opportunity we all kind of have to take, especially those of us who are at the wonderful chain to the anchor desk and get out a lot less often than we to talk to folks than we otherwise would. The salvation for the news business, I've had the beauty of being on this stage many times to talk about different news moments in our history, and the salvation for the news business is that we try to be more like that and not less like that. There's, as you know, an entire swath of the news business which doesn't understand what that means, which doesn't understand that telling a story and who tells the story and what voices you hear and the kinds of voices you hear is as important as what comes out of the anchor's mouth or comes out of the reporter's mouth. And my goal, you know, I'm involved with a group called the News Literacy Project, which is going into high schools and trying to tell people, train young people on what to hear or what to believe. And I think that that's our goal for the next generation, not only of journalists, but also of news consumers, for getting their information from so many places. And I think Walter would be proud of that approach to how we cover the news.
Scott, you were a young CBS correspondent after Walter left the anchor desk, but you've said in Douglas Brinkley's biography of him that he had a tremendous impact on you nevertheless, that he was a mentor to you. Can you tell us what that was like and how it's influenced what you're doing today?
Well, I knew Walter very informally because he had retired from CBS. But when I joined CBS in 1989, I sought out Walter and a number of other people who had... Let me just... There we go. Apparently, I've said enough already. I sought out, I had been an enormous fan of CBS, you know, growing up really in the 60s, watching television news, watching Walter Cronkite anchor the evening news through the tremendous, incredible period of time that he was working. The times were so much... a part of the Walter Cronkite we know. I mean, think about this period that he covered, the assassination of the president, Martin Luther King, Robert Kennedy, the civil rights movement, Vietnam, man on the moon, Watergate. I mean, it's astounding, an astounding period of time in American history, and Walter was the guy. Walter was the man throughout that entire period of time. But I sought out Walter and a number of other people at CBS that I just had admired all of those years. And Walter was very kind in meeting with me and introducing me to his wife, Betsy. And we spent a number of fun meetings together, talking about those old days and talking about what he hoped for the future at CBS News. I mean, nobody knew who I was. He had never heard of me. But just as Bob Schieffer was saying, and Leslie as well, he was so kind to take the time to talk to this new correspondent at CBS that I doubt very many people had much hope for. Well, so far, so good.
Leslie, you told the story in your book about when you were going to work election night with Walter Cronkite for the first time, and he invited you over to dinner at his house with his wife, and you weren't quite sure what to make of that or what was going to happen to you. Tell us about it, please.
You cut right to the chase, because this is the ribald
I know that.
Sense of humor. Well, I was very nervous because it was my first time ever anchoring on election night. And he invited me and my then boyfriend to dinner to relax me. And he just told unbelievably funny jokes all night long. He could imitate anybody. He could do women. He could do people you've heard of. And he entertained us and two other couples. And then he told, I've heard a lot of dirty jokes in my life. I actually like dirty jokes. This was the most vile, dirty joke I've ever heard. And after he told it, he said, I call that my clear the room joke. Everybody go home, because I'm tired.
How did it go?
Anyway.
And we never...
the truth is, he was all the things we've been saying. He was our moral, it's a kind of corny, but he was our moral beacon. He really, really was. He loved the news in the purest way, because we had standards. I remember him always saying, we don't, you know, go with what the wind is telling us to do. In other words, we don't hear from the public. What do you want to hear? Do you want to hear some, you know, tabloid story? No, we tell, but we make the judgment about what hard news is. And he stood by that the whole time he was anchor man.
You
and
know,
we wanted, just one more point.
Oh,
we lived to make him happy as reporters who worked for him. We lived to have Walter say good piece, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, here you go.
That was the greatest compliment that you could get when Walter, but Walter was very good about when you had a good story. He knew what a good story was, and he called and told you. And it wasn't, you know, he didn't call every night or anything like that. But, you know, when you'd worked on something really hard, the thing was that Walter had not spent his whole life in the studio, under the studio lights. He'd been a reporter. He covered the news. He knew it's not always easy to get that one little detail that you need to know that the story is correct. And so a compliment from Walter was just about as good as it could possibly get. But the thing about Walter that I think the reason people loved him so much and trusted him so much, he never tried to come off as someone who knew more about something than the people he was reporting for. He left the impression that he was just as interested in the news as the people who had turned it on that night, and that he had done his homework, and that he was prepared. And I mean, he would study. I mean, when he would do those long stints during the space program and those long times he would be on television, he has spent hours doing his homework and doing what anyone would do or should do and too often does not do. But I think it came across. Leslie said, what am I talking about doing your homework? It's kind of a novel concept sometimes today. But Walter did his work, and it was reflected in what he, when he reported those stories. And you know, when the boss sets certain standards, I firmly believe that What the boss does, the guy at the top of the heap does, is set the example for the rest of the troops. It's not giving people a bunch of orders and all of that. You watch how he does his work, and you figure out, wait a minute, that's how you're supposed to do it. And to me, that's what it was always, what I always loved about Walter. I mean, he just loved being a reporter, and it just came through in every single thing that he did.
Was he the first evening news anchor to go to the scene of the story as often as he did?
I don't know about that. I suppose he was, because he was the first. I mean, CBS, at that up and when Walter became the anchor of the evening news, Douglas Edwards had been the anchor when it was 15 minutes long, and it was interesting the way Doug got the job as we were going from radio to television. A lot of the folks, Murrah and some of the big radio guys, they didn't want to be on television. They didn't like the idea of having all those pictures up there. They thought the pictures would interrupt their words and people wouldn't hear what they were saying. So the first anchor was Doug Edwards, who was just, you know, he was a correspondent, and they picked him out, and he and Don Hewitt was the first producer of the evening news. But then when television became big and Walter became the anchor, and they went to a half hour during the Kennedy administration, that's when television news really began to come into his own. So I suppose he probably was, if he wasn't the first, he was certainly one of the first to originate the news from someplace other than the studio.
Well, and one of the reasons he was the first is, and we can't ignore this, is that technology completely changed the business. Scott can be sitting here with us tonight, and tomorrow, if there is a huge hurricane, we're going to see Scott there. That wasn't physically, technologically possible when Walter Cronkite and Huntley and Brinkley began anchoring the evening news. It was barely possible for them to get to the chair and read from the scrolling teleprompter as it was happening. So one of the things that I'm always curious about is how the Walter Cronkites of the world would deal with the technology and this pace that we are dealing with now, where you can't ignore a story that seems silly because you never know. Overnight it could pick up and suddenly become the story that's defining the campaign.
Let me just add one little thing about the technology and how primitive the technology, you all hear me? How primitive the technology was. When Doug Edwards was the first anchor, there was no such thing as a teleprompter. And Don Hewitt, who always, this was the guy who created 60 Minutes, was always thinking out of the box. So at one point, he tried to teach Doug Edwards Braille so he could, you know, do it and look straight in the camera while he was doing it. That's true. It's as true as I'm sitting here.
Say something about technology.
Yeah,
that's a fabulous.
Good.
But when I got there in the early 70s, we were still working with film, and film had to be developed, mm-hmm. and that took hours. Film had to be actually sent. Can you believe film had to be flown in?
Yes.
So if you had a report out of Vietnam, it was days before we saw it on the air. So we all had actual time to think. Sometimes hours, sometimes days, and that is going. There's no time. There's absolutely no time to think today.
Yeah, Scott, you not only go to the scenes of breaking stories that you're reporting on when they're big enough as the anchor, but you're still doing these, you know, deep pieces for 60 Minutes that require so much reporting. How important to you is it to be still be doing that much reporting while you're also anchoring?
Well, this gets to Bob's point, I think, about how Walter loved the news. The 60 Minutes work in the field gives me an opportunity to do those things that reporters really like to do.
Right.
Go out and meet people, find out for yourself, eyeball the scene for yourself, try to observe things that others aren't seeing. That's what Walter had always done before he began his television career, when he was working for United Press in World War II and at the Nuremberg trials and all of that. He was a reporter first, last, and always. And getting back to the point, Gwen's point about the technology, I think Walter did feel sort of chained to the studio when these enormous events were happening, because just as Gwen said, it just wasn't technologically possible for him to go. I think if Walter Cronkite was the anchor of the evening news today, one, we would all be better off, but two, he would go to all of these things. See, there's a lot of sentiment for that.
No, not that.
I don't know how to evaluate that applause.
No, I assure you, I'm no Walter Cronkite, but he would go to all of these things. Yeah. You would not be able to keep the man in the building on 57th Street. He would go to all of these things because he was a reporter, first, last, and always.
Right. Leslie, he was also a shaper of the news at a time when there were relatively few gatekeepers, only three networks, and only a few national newspapers with national impact. You worked on an important national story as a young reporter in Watergate when Bob and Carl were working on it at the Post. And there was that period when we felt all alone at the Post. I was one of the editors working on Watergate. And the Nixon administration was against us. Many of our peers in the news media were against us. And most of America didn't know anything about Watergate. And Walter wanted to do something about that. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, and it was in the midst of the 1972 election campaign, don't forget, Nixon's re-election campaign. And Walter decided that he was going to devote an enormous chunk of the evening news to tell the Watergate story, basically as Woodward and Bernstein had reported it, because there wasn't, as you said, very much other reporting. So he designed, Walter himself, two pieces that were going to run two consecutive nights, each about 14, 15 minutes long. And it was explosive. He did the first one, and Bob Woodward and I were friends back then. He called and he was, genuflecting, thank you, tell Walter, thank you. Because it gave them an imprimatur. But it was an explosive thing for Walter to have done. It was so huge that Bill Paley, who was the head of CBS, came in and said, you're not gonna do that on the second night. And Walter said, oh, yes, I am. But the second night ran, but it was only 7 minutes. But nevertheless, our audience in those days was enormous. Walter, first of all, the whole country was divided in three parts, those who watched NBC, those who watched CBS, and those who watched ABC, and there was nothing else to watch at 6:30, so everybody watched. That's how everybody got their evening news. And Walter was the most popular. We had the highest ratings, so gigantic number of people watched this. And it was their first education about what was happening with Watergate. This was before the hearings.
I have never cheered in the newsroom, and I cheered that night at the TV set. And it made an enormous difference, because then the rest of the media got onto the story. Cy Hirsch went to the New York Times, and I never was so grateful for competition.
Well, you can't imagine.
But it really made it a national story.
It did.
It was your reporting.
And it made it acceptable for the rest of the media to get involved.
But Bob, were you in the newsroom that night? I remember everybody standing as your newsroom.
Yeah.
We stood up. We had monitors of all the three networks, and we stood up and we applauded Walter for the courage of what he was doing.
Right.
Which is an important point to mention, is that there's a lot of, those were the good old days and part of our conversation here, but it could not happen like that again. It could not happen. There are not three networks which everyone is getting their news from. There are a zillion ways to get your information, including on your phone, including on your watch. And so we can't shape the entire, there are people doing amazing work right now in newspapers about Donald Trump's finances, and it has a little bit of effect, but not the huge effect it would have had if there were only a few sources. So it's nice to think about the good old days, but it's also important to remember it's not quite duplicatable.
Right. Well, that reminds me that Walter then followed up later on by going to Vietnam to do his own on-the-ground reporting at a time when the country was divided over what was happening in the war. The administration said it was going well. Reporters on the ground said it wasn't. He went. He decided it wasn't, and the audience saw this his brief excerpt from that report. So that's twice in which he essentially, I don't know if he would say expressed a point of view, but he certainly steered the news in a certain direction.
It was a point of view.
Yeah, it was a point
we
of view.
We pretend he was just straight down the middle telling you world as it was. But that was a decision.
Right.
Well, that,
so I wanted to ask Scott, how far do you think you can go?
It was labeled that way at the time. I'm sorry, Lynn?
I was going to say, how far do you think you can go in something like that? For instance, right now, there's this whole question over whether or not Trump gets an easier ride from the media and lies need to be called lies. How do you feel about your role as a reporting anchor on that?
Well, the documentary that you're talking about, the half-hour documentary, was right after the Tet Offensive in 1968.
Correct. And he was there.
And Walter did his interviews and did his field work, and then at the end, there was the famous commentary, and it was labeled at the time commentary. There was a lot of discussion between Walter and the then president of CBS News, Dick Salant, about whether to do that, how to do that, and how to label it, if you will, for the audience. So they decided that they would do it and that they would label the end of that documentary commentary. I don't believe Walter ever did anything like that before, and I'm not sure he did much of anything like that since then. We remember it very well because of how prescient it was.
Right.
It turned out to be exactly right, a prediction of what would happen about 6 years later. So it was discussed between Walter and Salant, and it was an important decision that was made, that they were going to step out and do this. Of course, Bill Moyers, who was deputy press secretary in the Johnson administration, claims that he heard President Johnson say, if I've lost Walter Cronkite, then I've lost Middle America.
It wasn't long after that he announced he wasn't going to run again.
It was about 5 weeks after that he announced that he wasn't going to run again. So your question is, can I do that? You know, I just don't believe opinion belongs in what I'm doing. The audience can figure out for themselves what they think about the news.
But has the line...
And that's really at the... That's the
I understand that line, but has the line towards what is opinion moved a little? Some of your hard-hitting 60-minute pieces, we look at your face, we listen to your questions, and it seems like you're driving towards something. Is that a fair assessment?
Well, I'm trying to drive to the truth if I can.
Yeah. Okay.
I think you do have to call them as you see them.
Right.
But there's a difference between pursuing the truth and the facts and laying them all out there, good, bad, or indifferent, and pressing a viewpoint that you have coming into the story. I think that's a line you don't cross.
Right. Even though so much of the rest of the cacophony now in the digital age is full of opinions, this is still important for network news to adhere to these standards.
This is CBS DNA, and it's because of Walter.
You know, I mean, the thing that made Walter's commentary, which was clearly labeled as that, so powerful is that he never took sides.
I got it.
And, you know, Ed Murrow wrote commentaries.
Yes.
And he became, you know, a great and influential journalist because he did express opinion. He did commentaries. Walter became famous because he didn't. And that made it even more powerful when he did decide to take a position on that. And you're absolutely right. I mean, George Christian, who was the president's press secretary at that time, told me, and I talked to him, Walter, I mean, LBJ did not actually see the broadcast. George Christian took it to him the next morning and showed it to him. And he turned to George and said, if I've lost Walter Cronkite, I've lost the American people. And that was that's how it happened.
But here's the problem,
and that's why it was so powerful. What, Gwen?
Well, I was just going to say that's the problem now. It's very murky for people. The question I get more often, especially on college campuses than any other, is how do you keep your opinion out of your question?
I was going to ask you that.
How do you not frown when someone is lying to you? How do you behave when someone who is clearly distasteful is speaking to you? And I say I don't have any problem with it because I want to hear the answer. And they're stunned at this because young people especially have been brought up in an era in which they've been force-fed people's opinions. And so they don't really, we don't make clear enough the distinction that Walter drew, the line that he drew between his reported opinion and his opinion. And this, I woke up this morning and I pulled this out of my ass and this is what I think. Of which there's way too much.
She learned how to talk like that at the Washington Post. Can I interject just one quick thing, Lesley, about that, just to proceed a step further? And that is, you moderated two debates, two vice presidential debates. There's a big controversy
Bob
now.
Bob is moderator of them, too.
Yeah, right. But I'm going to ask him the same question.
Right.
What is it? Although he's just written a column about what he thinks the role of the moderator is. We haven't heard from you yet. How do you see the role as moderator of debates in this really contentious time now?
I don't think most people know how hard it is to moderate a general election debate. There's not an audience cheering, screaming, carrying on. There are not 25 people on the stage.
Until this week.
But they were pretty subdued by primary standards. But your job is to try to elicit not only an answer to your question, which often is not forthcoming, but also to elicit a conversation between the two on the stage. I think there's a sweet spot between making yourself a partner of a party on the stage, where you're getting into the fight, and being prepared enough that if someone says something that's clearly untrue and the other candidate is not willing to challenge them, that you are. I don't think there's any problem with challenging truth on the stage. I just think that there's a sweet spot that many people don't appreciate that is very difficult. For instance, I thought what Lester Holt did that was good the other night was figure out when to ask a pointed question and when to sit back and let them engage. And that is a really hard thing to do. And there are a lot of people, a lot of moderators in primary debates just get up there and get in the fight. No one's voting for you. No one cares about your question. We only care about the answers. Your question doesn't become part of the clips later in the week. It's the answers that you want.
Well, I'm intrigued and troubled and struggling to figure out what the role of the, quote, mainline media, the small number of us who are left, what we do when someone does lie. Because if they lie, our role is to tell the truth. The truth is you lied. I think it should be part of our reporting, and we shouldn't be afraid to step out in front of it, including the anchorman, if it's just not true. I love that more and more reporters in mainline television and mainstream news are saying on both sides, you know, that what they said wasn't right.
But what you just said is the key. It's not equivalent. And we spend a lot of time trying to say, well, she lies and he lies. Well, one of them is lying a little more.
Yeah.
And that's a really hard, tough thing to say.
We certainly know where you're coming from.
I'm just listening.
I didn't mean you, I meant them. I meant them.
No, but you know, it's really hard this year. It's very different this year. There's no question. No, I know what you mean. I mean for them too. Because I don't care what I think. I care what you think. And it's really very difficult, even if you are someone with a strong point of view, but you still want to hear what the other side believes. It's really hard. I feel like I'm cutting out. I feel bad for voters this year. It's a very tough way to, you're not making your decision in the way that you've always made it before, and that increases the responsibility on us.
Scott, in Douglas Brinkley's biography, you talked about how impressed you were with the way that Cronkite handled the breaking news of former President Lyndon Johnson's death right in the middle of the evening news being on the air, which must be very challenging for an anchor. Can you describe why that? You were a relatively young person at that time. Can you tell me why that impressed you so much?
I didn't see it when I was 11.
Okay.
Which was my first year at CBS News. But I've seen it many times
yes.
since then.
Yes.
And I don't know if you saw it in the film about Walter, but what happens, 1973, no one knows this yet. Only Walter Cronkite knows this. But Lyndon Johnson has died en route to the hospital in San Antonio after suffering a heart attack at his ranch. The evening news is on the air. there's a story about Vietnam on, and suddenly they cut out of the middle of the story, and Walter is on the phone. And he, I don't know, can you hear me all right this way?
I'll hold it. All right,
because I got to use my hands. Walter is on the phone on live television, and he looks up at the audience and he goes,
can you imagine?
And he goes, all right, Tom, okay. All right, Tom, I got it. Puts a phone down and he says, I'm just talking to Tom Johnson, who is the press spokesman for the former president, and Lyndon Johnson died today en route to the hospital, et cetera, et cetera. Here's what I love about that. Walter didn't care anything about all the window dressing and everything has to be perfect on right. television and the format's calling for this story and that story. It was the news. And that's all he cared about. And if he had to be on the phone and tell the audience, hold on just a second.
I'm going to try that.
I'm going to be going to be right with you. And that's what we like to do at CBS. In fact, we did. I did it to poor Bob Schieffer just the other night. We were at the debate, and Bob was speaking, and we were talking about our impressions of the debate, and Governor Pence walks into our workspace. Didn't know he was coming. There he is, standing right there. And Steve Kappas, the executive producer, said, Mike Pence is in there. Get him on the air. And I thought, well, you know, how should we go about this? And Kappas said, it doesn't matter. Just get him. And so I just said, you know what? I'm talking to the audience. And this is what reminded me of Walter. I said, Mike Pence has just walked in here. Governor, why don't you come right over here and join us? And I had to lean over to Bob Schieffer, my hero. And I took his microphone off his lapel and gave it to the governor of Indiana. And so,
which is the equivalent of doing this.
It's the equivalent of doing this, exactly right. I don't know how it looked on the air, but that's the important thing. It doesn't matter. It was news.
Right.
And that's what I love about that moment with Walter. Right.
And next week, I'm going to bring my own microphone.
That'll teach you.
Now, Bob, similarly, more seriously, was that amazing time on the air when he had to announce the death of John F. Kennedy. And you were on the ground in Dallas doing amazing reporting work at the time.
Yeah, I
for
was a
another TV
reporter.
Station?
No, I was a reporter at the Fort Worth Star-Telegram.
Fort Worth Star-Telegram, right. And so I assume you didn't see it when it was live, but you certainly saw it later. And so what do you think the impact of that was? The way in which he showed evident emotion, the way in which he was on the air checking reports, telling you that he was still checking out reports before he made the final announcement. Again, it was seeing him behave like a newsman in person.
Well, again, it was Walter. People understood that Walter cared. And, I mean, how could you not be moved? And he didn't do anything fancy or, again, talking like he was checking the stuff, and when they finally handed him the note that said the president is dead, he kind of blinked his eyes, and we all remember that moment, you know, and that we would never forget. But again, Walter Cronkite being a reporter, this was Walter Cronkite waiting until he had the facts exactly and he was certain of it before he broadcast it. I mean, so much of the time now, talking about the role of the mainstream media now, you know, what's different now is there's so much information out there now that is just totally wrong.
Yeah.
It's not that it's, you know, sort of right or we need to check one more detail. Much of it now is wrong by design. People put it out there to mislead. And we noticed at CBS News, and I know Scott will remember things that happened that day too, that our job that day was going to be knocking down false reports. And you know, Lynn, we all know, we all were brought up in journalism that when your news organization makes a mistake and you realize it's a mistake, you correct it as quickly as you can. But generally, if your competition made a mistake You would just leave it there. You wouldn't mention it and wait until they corrected it. On 9/11, we understood that we risked setting off mass hysteria if we didn't knock down these false reports. That, I mean, I can't tell you how many times on 9/11 we got this report that there was another plane headed toward the Sears Tower in Chicago. We would stop what we were doing in the Washington Bureau, go back, report again. There is no truth.
Or that several different buildings had already been hit in Washington. We'd have sent out reporters to every one of them to see who was still standing.
And, I mean, there's been so much talk about fact-checking, you know, in this debate season. But I think the role of the national media now, I mean, the mainstream media, is fact-checking. I mean, knocking down false reports before they set off, you know, literally panic.
Right.
And we spend a lot of time, and Scott will back this up, knocking down false reports at CBS News. Sometimes we don't even report it, but we spend a good part of our time doing that.
Same thing in newspaper newsrooms.
Yeah.
Lesley, one of your loves clearly was investigative reporting. It's been my whole career devoted to it in one way or another. How do you see accountability journalism today when media economic models are crashing and there's all this other competition and the lies and the things on the internet and so on? I contend it's probably one of the most important roles for mainstream media in addition to verification. How do you see it?
Well, I think we are in that interregnum between an age where there was enough money around to afford investigative reporting. The reason you need the money is because it takes a lot of time to do these stories. And now that so much of media is shifting to the internet and in narrow little organizations without a big audiences and without a lot of money, at the moment, we're just waiting to see how the shift is going to be made and how we're going to have enough money. I hate to be crass about it, but you just have to have enough money. How we're going to get enough money to attract the brightest kids in the class to do this kind of work, to afford to have one person, two people, go out and spend 3 months, 6 months working on one story. What I'm seeing right now is investigative reporters leaving organizations, traditional newspaper, and even television, and looking around for places where they can, you know, apply their skills, and continue to do what they love to do. We're in that middle period. It's kind of a sad period in my eyes. But I think we're going to come out okay in the end. I see foundations pouring money into it. I see organizations like Microsoft and Google putting some money in. So eventually it's going to shake out. And we need it, just what you said. You know, one of the strengths of this country, it kills me when these politicians go after the press the way they do. It's very deliberate. I'm going to tell you something. Trump told me himself. I asked him, why are you always hounding us? What is the purpose of just beating us on the head every day? He says, well, I'm trying to get out ahead of your stories. I'm discrediting you so the public won't believe the stories. So there's a method. I think the reason that this country is the country in the world that's the least corrupt is because we have had a strong press and a strong investigative arm of the press. And I'm tooting our own horn, but it is so important to the country. People sad that they are looking upon us and not trusting us.
Gwen, in addition to adding to her, what is the role of public broadcasting in this?
Well, let me toot her horn her for a moment, since it's so unseemly to toot one's own. 60 Minutes.
That never stopped you before.
I know. It is a disaster and a shame that 60 Minutes is our only real investigative news program on the air. It is also a wonderful thing that 60 Minutes exists, because aside from the resources, which we know is a drama, it devotes the time. What we need more than anything else, for instance, we sit here and talk about fact-checking. All of the discussion leading up to debate was about instant fact-checking. I don't care about the instantaneousness of it as much as I care about someone having thought about it enough to put it in context. Sometimes you don't need or can't figure it out instantly, but maybe you can figure it out by the next day enough to put it in context. I think what public broadcasting has is time. We have an hour of uninterrupted time every night. We have Frontline every week. We have The Choice, which is 2 hours this week of telling us about things I thought I knew about these candidates, but it turns out, according to our viewer response, a lot of people didn't know.
Really? Hillary was on the Watergate committee?
What? You didn't know that? So you do a real value and a service in reminding people and taking the time, the uninterrupted time, of telling the story well. That's why I don't despair that there are all these different places to get information. There have to be places to go for all of it. Everybody doesn't want to know that much. But for those who do, that's what public broadcasting exists to do. That's what's important. And of course, in order for us to do that, we'd need money, people like you. Thank you very much. I'll take your checks on the way out the door. Your tote bags are in the mail. But more important than that...
She's not going to stop talking until you start sending in those...
Scott has known me for a while. He's right through me. But I will circle back around to the importance of something like 60 Minutes. It just doesn't exist. It's the reason why it still gets amazing ratings, which makes me very happy, is the fact that there is still an audience out there for
that. Right. Bob, we have time for one more comment before we ask the audience for questions. So it's time for you to tell us about your big scoop.
Well, it was 1976. President Ford, and I was covering him that year, was running he had been the first unelected president. He was running to be elected in his own right. And we went up. The big story then was the flu shots. Were people going to take their flu shots? Because people were getting sick when they took them, and there was a real question about whether they were going to be able to continue this program. So that was the big story, that and the election. And so President Ford went up to New York, and they made some reason for going. But really, the reason he went up there was to be interviewed by Barbara Walters, who was the host of the Today Show at that time, and I must say the strongest competitor I ever competed against. She was really, really something. So anyway, she did the interview at mid-morning after the Today Show, and then put out the word that if anyone interviewed the president before that interview ran the next morning on the Today Show, they would be killed.
I can hear that.
Barbara had a way of making people believe that might really happen. So, being reporters, we all set about, it became our objective to bust Barbara's scoop. And so I went to the press secretary and said, do you think I might? No, we've told Barbara we're not going to do that. No interviews. So I then next went to a fellow who I later would call Mr. Vice President. I called him Dick in those days, Dick Cheney, the president's 32-year-old White House chief of staff. And I will say here, the straightest, the most nonpartisan, the most helpful aide that I ever worked with, especially in the White House. I mean, there were four or five of us in the press corps. We didn't even talk to the press secretary. We just called the chief of staff. We talked to him all day. He'd tell us yes or no about these things. And so I said, do you think that might be possible to interview the president? And he said, no, Bob, we've given our word to Barbara Walters. And I said, yeah, but I said, you know, Walter Cronkite, he wants to come out and join us up at Yonkers. They were going up there. And I said, he wants to, you think it might be possible to get Walter he said, Bob, we just can't do this. And I said, well, let me ask you this. I said, could I just get Walter in to say hello? I said, I know the president likes him. And he said, well, yeah, we could do that. And he said, and I said, do you think it would be all right if we brought a camera crew in? Just, I said, you know, just so Walter could have a souvenir. And he said, Bob, we're not going to do any interviews. And I said, but what about just, he said, okay, I'll let him come in. And so anyway, we go to the back door of where the president was about to appear. And the cameraman was here, and Walter was here. And Walter took the microphone in his left hand. They led us in there. He walked straight up to Gerald Ford and said, Mr. President, are you going to take your flu shot? President Ford almost, I mean, he almost broke out into a horse laugh because he knew what Walter was doing, and he liked Walter, and he said, yes, Walter, he said, I think the president needs to set an example. I'm going to take the flu shot. Well, the evening news that night started exactly this way. Good evening. President Ford told me in an exclusive interview on the campaign trail tonight that the president would take his flu shot. And then we proceeded to play the entire interview, all 9 seconds of it. Now, that... That, if you'll let me finish the story.
Yeah, exactly.
If the, no one but Walter Cronkite knew how all that came about. My fingerprints were nowhere on it. But from that day forward, Walter Cronkite was my biggest backer and mentor. And when you worked at CBS News, when Walter Cronkite was there, that was a pretty good deal. And it served me well. That's
great
the
story.
Biggest coup
great
I ever
story.
Got.
Now we have time for questions from the audience, which we need to record because this whole thing is being recorded. I'm not quite sure. Oh, there are microphones up here. There's one here and there's one over there. So please use the microphone. We'll start over here.
Hi, good evening. My name is Morgan Jamison. I'm from Fairfax County, local native here to the area. As somebody who grew up in the tail ends, I'm 28 years old, in the tail ends of Cronkite's career and believed in actual journalism as it used to be, and who still believes in what 60 Minutes and otherwise is today. What message do you have that Walter would have today to my generation in terms of valuing the media in front of them and not clicking the clickbait stories in front of them and actually reading and understanding those facts? What message would you have for folks my age?
Gwen, I think you said you work with news literacy. You want to go first?
Sure. I mean, I think the responsibility is on us to go where you are, honestly. We belong past the point where I'm going to talk you away from the clickbait. But it means that we have to find a way to converse in the language that you use and to converse not to do Brangelina hits every day, but to find a way to make the stories we need to tell accessible. So there is no excuse that someone doesn't know what Aleppo is. I won't name any names, but it won't be because we didn't tell you. I had a student tell me a couple of weeks ago, I'm a millennial, and I don't understand why you don't talk more about climate change. And I said, well, millennials who take in their information through social media have a choice about what they want to know about, and the information is there. And so click on where you want to go. Why is it that when I post a story about the hunger strikes in Venezuela, you click on someone who fell off a curb? And that's what gets all the attention. So the responsibility is not just on it is partly on us to go where you are, but it's also on you to actually seek out the information that you want. It's there.
Anybody want to add to that?
You know, I think Walter would guide this generation back to first principles. There is no democracy without journalism. And the quality of our democracy is linked directly to the quality of our journalism. One of the things that has made our country great is the quality of the journalism. No country has the quality of journalism that we have. We're criticized a lot, and that's a good thing. We live in a skeptical age, and I think all the criticism we get, we should get. It makes us think about the things that we do, and that's a good thing. But we have the greatest journalism schools in the world. Arizona State leaps to mind. And they are putting out a new generation of young people who want to do journalism right. It is my responsibility, it's Gwen's responsibility, Bob, Leslie, Len. It's our responsibility to help those young people understand how important journalism is to our society and how important it is that the journalism that we have is of the highest quality. Bob Schieffer says, everywhere I appear with Bob Schieffer talking to young people, he says, imagine the corruption that we would have at the federal, state, and local level, very importantly, if it wasn't for watchdog journalism. And one of the things, and I don't want to speak for you, Bob, but one of the things Bob talks about is the demise of local newspapers and how that is going to inevitably create a situation in which corruption is a much bigger problem mm-hmm. on the state and local level than it is today. We just have to make sure that we understand the importance of journalism before it's too late.
Let me just say, you have to understand where we are right now. We are in the midst of a communications revolution. Everything is changing, and it is changing at warp speed. We have access to more information than any human beings who have ever lived on the earth at any time in our history.
Beam me up.
But here is the thing. Are we more informed, or are we simply overwhelmed with so much information that we can't process it? And that's what we're trying to sort out now. And that's why, you know, I did an op-ed piece at Len's newspaper, The Washington Post, the other day. They put it online first, on their digital service first. It was on a Wednesday. Then they called me and said, you come down and we pull some videotape of old debates that you moderated. We want to do a video package on it. And I said, I did that. And then on Sunday, it ran in the paper, Washington Post. It's no longer a case of this is not a newspaper anymore or a television network anymore. These are media companies, and we are having to reach people on totally different platforms. None of us know where all this is coming out, but I think there's still a whole lot of good journalism out there. And I think we're seeing a lot of good journalism during this campaign. But this is, we're in the midst of something like we've never gone through before in communications, and we're just going to have to see how it goes from here, and we have to stick and be for and stand for the kind of things that Walter Cronkite stood for. That's the first part of it.
Gentleman over there.
Yeah. Thank you very much for, you're an amazing group of people, and it was a wonderful program. I grew up watching Walter Cronkite in the 60s and 70s, and I'm struck by the fact that he lived until 2009, and I'm assuming some of you knew him up, you know, through those years. And of course, the question we'd like to ask is, you know, what would he think if he were alive today? Well, he's not. But what did he think about journalism in his latter years, you know, into the 1990s, into the 2000s? Do we have any information on that?
Leslie, you want to go first?
I can't answer your question. I did see Walter in his later years. He was in New York, and I guess did he go out to the Arizona?
Yes, he went to the Walter Cronkite School a lot and talked to students.
Did he talk about this?
I was not there yet. I was still at the Washington Post, but
I used to see Walter a lot in his later years. He remained interested until the end. His interests were the same at the end of his life as they were at the beginning of his life, and he had questions. He had questions about how the news was being covered, and he always wanted to know, what do you hear about so-and-so? Walter wanted to know the news, the big news, but he also liked to gossip, and he wanted to know what was going on in the industry, and he was wonderful to be around in those last years.
There was a video shown here earlier today of his visits to the Walter Cronkite School, and he was exactly that way. He was deeply curious about what the students were doing, how journalism was changing, giving them advice on how to build their careers. He had, according to the students who were interviewed in this video, he had a big impact on them personally.
This reminds me, if you'll forgive me, of one of the last times that I saw Walter before he passed. We were at the White House Correspondents' Dinner, And I was standing in a hallway with Walter, and we were chatting, and Ken Burns comes over, and Ken starts talking, and all three of us are sitting there having a great time and a cocktail. And pretty soon, Walter begins to sway, and then he goes down like a tree, unconscious. Whoa. I catch him. I've got him by the armpits. Ken Burns picks up his ankles. So now Ken Burns and I have got Walter Cronkite, and we're trying to wrestle him into an adjacent room, and we get him in there, and we put him down in the chair, and I know that his wife, Betsy, is sitting outside. She hasn't seen any of this. Ooh. So I go running out, and I say, Betsy, Walter has fainted. And she looked up, and she said, he does that all the time. By the time Betsy and I got back in the room, Walter had his cocktail in his hand, and he was just fine.
That's great.
But, gentleman over here?
To Bob's point, he was sharp and curious all the way to the end of his life, and a wonderful, wonderful man to know.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
This has been a huge privilege for me to listen to you all speak today. My question for each of you is, what's the role of entertainment today in good journalism? You guys have used the term good journalism a couple of times.
I can start on that one.
Thank you.
Okay.
And because 60 Minutes has been accused of using entertainment techniques in our storytelling, I of course wouldn't call it entertainment myself. But when we tell a story at 60 Minutes, and our kind of journalism, which is kind of halfway between hard news and documentary journalism, we do try to have an arc in the way we tell our story. And also on 60 Minutes, we tell all kinds of stories. We are the full newspaper. We have the front page. We have the medical page. We have Brangelina, if we could get them, that would be. But I do think that news has to, today, more than when Walter was around, because I told you Walter had the, you don't listen to what's out there, what people want. Today, I think we cater to the audience more than we used to. So there has to be good storytelling. If that's entertainment, fine. But we, at 60 Minutes anyway, Walter's message was, tell me a story, and that's basically what we do at 60 Minutes.
And it should be noted that Edward R. Murrow...
Edward R. Murrow did a lot of entertainment interviews. He's known as being Mr. Straight News, I will tell you the truth, but he also was talking to Ella Fitzgerald. So.
Yeah, he was interviewing celebrities in their homes. Yeah.
Yeah. Don Hewitt used to call it High Murrow and Low Murrow.
Right. Last question.
So I grew up in the days where I was the remote control. I was the UHF, VHF controller. And there are students here who are too embarrassed to get up. But I think Mr. Cronkite would be very appreciative to know that there are three young ladies here, four, and some people in the back who are part of Arizona State. I'm not affiliated with anything about Arizona State. I'm a private citizen and a benefactor of the museum. I do believe that it's important to realize that journalism still lives, hopefully, truthfully, in our young ones, because I'm old. And I was the remote controller. So please stand up. All of you who are part of Arizona State, please stand up. And thank you to all of you. I have met you all personally and have had very interesting stories with all of you. And I just have to say that if it wasn't for you, we wouldn't be able to assimilate and recognize and then decide what we want the news to be. Because at the end of the day, it's what you report to us, but it is our responsibility to recognize what's important to us and then act upon that, because that's the museum that we're in.
Well,
thank you so very much.
Thank you, because I want you to, I think I can fairly say for everyone on the stage, we wouldn't be here if it weren't for the students who stood up tonight. I would be despairing of my craft, of my profession, if I didn't think there was another generation that was coming along to do it the right way and to learn and to teach me things, frankly, that Snapchat, I don't get yet. But I wanna, well, I don't really wanna know, but there are some. But I do want the people who use these different platforms to tell the stories, to tell the arc, to tell it right. I do want them to have the basics of journalism, which drive them. I don't want them to forget who Walter Cronkite was and why he was. To heck with us. We want to be able to step away from this and make sure it's still genuine and real. And for that reason, you know, we come here. For that reason, we go to college campuses. For that reason, we want to raise another generation of people who know that there's a way to tell the story.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you. Good way to end. Thanks, all of you. And thanks to our panel for devoting their evening to us and to Walter Cronkite. Long live Walter Cronkite.